I made a point form of just all the issues that are identified or that surround the Passover, the things that happened all around the Passover that are identified with Passover. Okay, restoration. And I may or may not get to various scriptures, but we will eventually, I suppose, in the next coming weeks. But restoration. Passover is a time of restoration. And every year in Passover, I've preached out of 2 Chronicles chapters 29 and 30, which is the pattern of restoration. And there is the pattern of restoration in 2 Chronicles 29 and 30 is not complete. It's not fulfilled without a restoration to the Passover. Or we know in the New Testament terms what Passover is. Christ is our Passover. Okay, in fact, that's the only reference to the word Passover in the New Testament, is to identify it with Christ, and more specifically with the crucifixion of Christ. One of that older message Brother Stair was playing before 6 o'clock here, he's played it a number of times. Are you sure you want to be a Christian? I heard him say. Am I sure I want to be a Christian? And so we get down to the nitty-gritty, because you shall be hated of all men, and all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. All right, so Passover, Christ our Passover. But anyway, before there was a restoration, there had to be a restoration of the Passover. 2 Chronicles chapters 29 and 30. I'll make some references to it, although I won't go there and read from the scripture itself. But, you know, in the people of God were in a condition at that time where they had not taken the Passover in a long time in such sort as it was written. It had been a long time since they kept that Passover the way the Bible instructed them, or the law at that time instructed them to keep the Passover. And so that was the whole call. That was the whole call from Dan to Beersheba. Everybody come to Jerusalem to keep the feast of the Lord's Passover. And they went out, the posts went out, and everybody mocked them. And the Bible says, nevertheless, there were a few that did come to keep the feast. So it had to be a restoration to the Passover. And as the custom is, we're going to identify Passover with Christ, again, more specifically with his crucifixion, which implies to us now that we pick up our cross and we must suffer with him. And this is part of the restoration of all things. Restoration to the Passover. A restoration to the faith once delivered to the saints. A faith that believed and had hope in substance of things not seen. So vital, so real, so vivid, so true. Witnessed so completely in their mind and spirit and heart that they were not careful to answer, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were not careful to lay everything aside, lay down their very life, and pick up their cross and deny themselves. See, that's the Passover. In the spiritual sense. And we'll get to it, you know, except you eat the flesh and drink the blood of the Son of Man, you have no life in him. Demarcation point. That was the council of division. That was the sword that cut religiosity away from true Christianity. Was that council. John chapter 6. Except you eat the flesh, drink the blood, you have no life in you. Well, this is a hard saying. We can't handle it. We can't hear this. This is weird. This is God doesn't want us to suffer or whatever. You understand? And from that time, many walked back and walked no longer with him. See, this is the crux of the matter. It's the crux of the matter. And that's why Passover is so vital. So anyway, that was 2 Chronicles chapters 29 and 30. They could not have restoration until they had restoration of the Passover. All right? Fits right in with the altar. And Elijah, now we know who's amongst us in the spirit and power of Elijah. It's Brother Stair. He is the man of God. And in his as a prophet, in his role, as God sent him, as the scripture also says, he repairs the altar of the Lord, which had been broken down. Now, what has been broken down by religion? People's acknowledgement and willingness to lay everything down, to lay everything aside, to endure sufferings, to all of that. That's what has been broken down. Because the altar is you. You're the altar. I've always said it that way. Your flesh is the altar upon which the life of Christ will be sacrificed again. And so it's not by our works of our own righteousness, but it's by a pursuit of learning how to crucify the old man and yield our members to the leading of the Holy Ghost, who will lead us into the sufferings of Christ. Yea, and all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. All right, but that without restoration to the Passover in that sense, then there's no full restoration. Now, does this happen overnight? Is this something that I can just change my mind on Thursday and start becoming a true bearer of the cross on Friday? Or is it something that's a culture thing that takes a continual preparation and renewing of the mind and practice and godly exercise of whatever involves a godly exercise? Right? Obedience, prayer, fasting, walking by faith, whatever. All elements of godly exercise and pursuit of being transformed into the image of Jesus Christ. So that divine nature, it's not that you can be Jesus Christ because I decide in my own will and by my own efforts, I would like to be but like Jesus, so I will try to make my own flesh conform. It's not quite like that, all right? And I'm going to bring something up in Exodus chapter 12 about the Passover. Different instructions concerning the Passover. And we'll hopefully get to it. One of the instructions is, you shall not eat of it raw. You just can't take the will of your flesh and decide that you are going to suffer and do it by the will of your flesh. Just by a raw mental assent. You can't do it. And why am I saying that? Because when I say that, then it's easier to understand, or it's more intuitive that there has to be some kind of preparation. There has to be some kind of, something you go through that brings you to a condition that you and the Holy Ghost can do this thing. But you're not going to do it raw. There's no such thing as righteousness of any kind, just raw out of the flesh. No such thing. So what does it mean? It means there's a preparation. And let's relate it to the word Sabbath, because Sabbath, generally we think of rest, but more importantly than rest sometimes is the preparation for the Sabbath. And this likewise with Passover. Even more important than entering into the Passover and partaking of the Passover is the preparation to bring you into the Passover. It'll take a preparation. You'll have to be prepared. Well, there's more references to that. All right. But I digress back to what I was saying a few minutes ago. What is Passover identified with? And this is not necessarily a complete list, but it'll give you an idea of how thorough and comprehensive and how many issues are surrounding and associated with Passover.